In the heat of World War II, America's quest for aerial supremacy led engineering feats ever attempted. At the forefront was the XP-55 Ascender, an aircraft so advanced it looked like something out of science fiction. With its 1,275 horsepower engine innovatively placed behind the cockpit, the XP-55 was designed to maximize aerodynamic efficiency and maneuverability. Its canard wings provided additional lift and improved control at low speeds, while the twin tails enhanced stability and control, making these pioneering features that set it apart from anything seen before. One of the most remarkable aspects of the XP-55 was one of its safety features for pilots. In the event of a bailout, pilots could jettison the pusher propeller, ensuring a clear and safe exit from the aircraft. With a design as audacious as its aspirations, the XP-55 was intended to surpass contemporary American fighters like the P-38 Lightning, P-40 Warhawk, and P-51 Mustang, offering superior speed and agility. Could this daring experiment redefine aerial combat to achieve total dominance? In early 1939, as political and military tensions engulfed Europe and the Third German Reich became a threat to the French and British, the United States military prepared for a future conflict in the Old World and, more importantly, the Pacific against the Empire of Japan. The U.S. Army Air Corps found itself unprepared to face the new aircraft. Its future counterparts were deploying for a new era of air warfare. The stakes were high. On November 27, 1939, the Army issued Proposal R-40C, calling for a fighter aircraft that would surpass any existing fighter in the American arsenal in every aspect. Army Air Corps Major Edward M. Powers, the officer behind the request, desired an aircraft with a high top speed, top-notch maneuverability, superior armament that could tackle enemy fighters and bombers alike, and excellent visibility for the pilot so that he could be aware of any threats around him. In addition to these performance requirements, the proposal also emphasized a low initial cost and easy, inexpensive maintenance. As if that was not enough, the Army was open to considering unconventional aircraft configurations that defied the standard designs of the time. Over 50 responses were received, but less than a dozen made it. Eventually, the USAAC settled down to four designs submitted by Northrop, Curtiss, Bell, and Vultee. In a daring leap towards the future, Curtiss Wright, under the innovative eye of designer Donovan Berlin, ventured into uncharted skies with the CW-24. This aircraft was unlike anything previously seen, featuring a revolutionary swept-wing pusher configuration with the elevator positioned boldly at the nose and twin fins and rudders gracing its wingtips. Pioneering for its time, the CW-24 also included tricycle landing gear, a stark departure from the conventional designs of the era. At the heart of this ambitious machine was the experimental Pratt & Whitney X1800 engine, an H-shaped behemoth with 28 cylinders spread across four rows, which promised a staggering 2,000 horsepower aimed at propelling the aircraft beyond the 500 miles per hour. Parallel to this, Northrop ventured into similarly unconventional territory with the XP-56 Black Bullet, another contender in the quest for aerodynamic supremacy. The XP-56 was an audacious design characterized by its unique flying wing configuration. It eliminated the need for a fuselage and tail assembly, pushing the boundaries of traditional aircraft design even further. This bold approach underlined an era where the limits of aviation technology were not just tested but expanded, setting the stage for the future of aerial combat and aircraft design. In June 1940, Curtiss Wright was awarded an Army contract to develop a wind tunnel model designated P-55. The wind tunnel tests lasted from November 1940 to January 1941, leaving the Army dissatisfied with the results. Thus, Curtiss Wright decided to develop its full-scale mock-up for testing. This prototype, crafted from welded steel tubing with wooden wings and fabric covering, took to the skies powered by a modest 275-horsepower Manasco engine. Its trials at the Muroc bombing range in California showcased commendable performance, albeit with a top speed of 180 miles per hour due to the engine's limitations. However, the innovative spirit of the CW-24 shone through as adjustments were made to enhance its stability, including the enlargement and repositioning of its wingtip fins and adding dorsal and ventral fins to the fuselage. Over 169 flights were conducted between December 1941 and May 1942. Following these tests, the aircraft was transferred to Langley Field, Virginia, for additional testing under the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, or NACA. In July 1942, the Army Air Corps issued a contract to produce three prototypes equipped with Allison Vi 1710 engines providing over 1,275 horsepower, leading to the cancellation of the X-1800 engine. The design was dubbed XP-55 Ascender, but pilots soon began referring to it as the Ascender due to its unusual pusher design. Unlike more conventional American aircraft, such as the P-38, P-40, and P-51, the XP-55 design mounted the engine behind the cockpit, with the pilot driving an aft-mounted pusher propeller, a feature that set it apart from its contemporaries. In contrast, the P-38 had a twin-engine configuration with the engines mounted on twin booms and the cockpit in a central nacelle. Likewise, the P-40 featured a tractor configuration with the engine and propeller at the front of the aircraft. Furthermore, the XP-55 Ascender featured a canard design with small forewings on the fuselage, a feature that added to its impressive design. Curtis considered that the Ascender's innovative configuration provided more benefits than conventional airplane designs. First of all, the fighter would be more efficient due to the position of the propeller right behind the fuselage. This would increase the overall efficiency of the plane by reducing the profile drag and making it more maneuverable. The reason was simple. A pusher required less stabilizing of the vertical tail area, presenting less weathercock effect. The shorter fuselage would also result in a dramatic decrease in the fuselage wetted area and weight, turning the XP-55 into a more agile and stable platform. Another characteristic of the XP-55 was a jettison system for the propeller. If the pilot bailed out, he pulled a lever that completely detached the propeller from the aircraft, providing him a clear exit to jump out. Besides its canard design, the XP-55 Ascender also featured twin tails and swept wings, another innovation for its time. This type of wing was uncommon during the period, as there was not enough information available to corroborate that its employment significantly reduced drag caused by the formation of shockwaves. Although the Germans had already been conducting studies since the early 1930s, the theories were unknown to their American counterparts, adding more mystery to Curtis's design. Lastly, the XP-55 pioneered tricycle landing gear in American aeronautics before it became the standard for all U.S. aircraft. Overall, the Ascender had a length of 29 feet, a wingspan of 40 feet, and a height of 10 feet. It had a gross weight of over 7,700 pounds. Initially, the prototypes were expected to be armed with two 20mm Hispano autocannons and two 50 caliber M2 Browning machine guns, but none was ever fitted with the desired armament due to testing problems. The first XP-55 prototype made its first flight on July 19, 1943, and met its tragic fate on November 15, 1943, when test pilot Harvey Gray experienced a severe pitch issue during a trial flight. The aircraft went into an uncontrollable descent from 16,000 feet, prompting Gray to bail out successfully. The prototype was lost entirely. Already under construction during the prototype's crash, the second XP-55 Ascender incorporated some quick modifications based on the initial findings. These included an enlarged elevator, a modified tab system, and changes from balance tabs to spring tabs on the ailerons. This prototype was subjected to restricted flight conditions to avoid the stall issues noted in its predecessor. Featuring more extensive modifications, the third Ascender was equipped with 4.50 caliber machine guns and had increased wing length and elevator travel limits to improve stall resistance. However, these adjustments initially allowed the pilot to stall the aircraft during takeoff, leading to further modifications and the addition of a mechanical stall warning device. As testing progressed, similar modifications were applied to the middle prototype. However, persistent stability issues and the non-availability of the planned X-1800 engine hindered the XP-55's performance. By 1944, with emerging jet technologies overshadowing propeller-driven designs, the XP-55 project was ultimately abandoned. The third prototype bewildered the public during an air show at Wright Field, Ohio on May 27, 1945. The event gathered a crowd exceeding 100,000 spectators. The skies were filled with unique American aircraft, including the Douglas XB-19 and the advanced P-59 Era Comet, one of the Army's first jet-powered fighters. At around 4 p.m., an aerial display traversed the field. Captain William C. Glasgow, a 28-year-old from Niagara Falls, spearheaded the formation. The veteran pilot, who had seen plenty of combat and had been decorated with the Silver Star, Distinguished Flying Cross, and other decorations, piloted the experimental XP-55 Ascender. He performed a slow roll post-field pass, followed by a continued flight path. However, Glasgow's execution appeared unstable, wobbling left and right. Tragedy struck seconds later when the aircraft swooped close to the ground and tore off 150 feet of fence. What followed was a fiery eruption, quickly shrouded in dark smoke. The seasoned pilot and four civilians lost their lives instantly. The third XP-55 prototype turned into rubble. But it was not all lost for the Ascender. The second prototype was in perfect condition and was transferred from Freeman Field to Park Ridge, where it remained dormant for half a century. It was not until 2001 that it was trucked to the Kalamazoo Aviation History Museum in Southwest Michigan for restoration, where it remains today. According to the National Air and Space Museum, quote, pilots feared the Ascender's vicious stall characteristics, and it was just plain slow compared to most fighters already in production. Although an innovative design, the XP-55 Ascender's overall performance was not as impressive as that of its contemporaries. During test flights, the XP-55 achieved a top speed of around 390 miles per hour at 19,300 feet. This pushed the fighter to the limit, leading to engine cooling problems. Another problem that test pilots reported during the routine test flights was handling. While the XP-55 excelled during routine flight at cruising speeds, it became overly sensitive at slow speeds, exacerbated by its primitive canard design. Although it could reach speeds of approximately 390 miles per hour, the XP-55's overall performance frequently fell short compared to the more traditional fighter aircraft already in service. For instance, the P-51 Mustang could fly 400 miles per hour without issues plaguing the Ascender. It could also carry bombs, a feature the XP-55 lacked. The P-40 Warhawk was slower than the Ascender, reaching a top speed of around 340 miles per hour. Nonetheless, it had a short takeoff distance and had excellent handling characteristics. With the advent of jet fighter technology, the XP-55 Ascender was quickly phased out in favor of more conventional airframe designs powered by jet technology. Germany's introduction of the Mi-262 Swallow in 1944, the world's first powered fighter, proved the future of air combat belonged to jet aircraft. Britain and the US closely followed this trend. Curtis saw the writing on the wall and phased out the Ascender abruptly. Nonetheless, the XP-55 contributed valuable data on the canard configuration, allowing aircraft engineers to study how aircraft stability could be managed with non-traditional configurations. The pusher configuration was another area where the XP-55 provided essential insights. Although this configuration did not become standard in later fighter designs, understanding its implications for aircraft handling and maintenance helped refine future experimental designs. All in all, the XP-55 Ascender, just like the Vultee XP-54 and the Northrop XP-56, collectively expanded the boundaries of what was considered technically feasible at the time and paved the way for more radical innovations in aircraft design that would appear in subsequent decades.